Meet Ali. Ali's birth celebrations actually began 3 months prior to his arrival into this world. The moment the ultrasound confirmed that it was a he, the family was just overjoyed. A blue theme color baby shower was held, and his mother was treated like a queen. Soon after his birth, the family started looking around for the best school. His extracurriculars were planned very carefully in order to make sure that he grows up into a successful and well-rounded individual. And although his grades always remained mediocre, they did send him abroad for higher studies because that was his dream. And he was destined to fulfill them. This is Asma, Ali's younger sister. And although they have the same parents, the same family, the same circumstances, Asma's life story is very different. The trajectory chosen for her and her destiny is starkly different from that of her brothers. Asma's birth was overshadowed by the fact that the family really, really wanted and expected a brother for Ali. And although their father was very educated, he did not really think that the girls needed to study beyond a particular point. They were meant to be good wives. So unlike Ali, in spite of the fact that her grades were much better, she only did her bachelor's and then stayed at home to be married off to a near relative at the age of 20. In keeping with the wishes of her in-laws, she never used any contraception and conceived very quickly. Her health was never good while she was pregnant. And the in-laws would just say, this happens with everyone. Sabne bache paida kiye. Aise hota hai. It's okay. As they always believed in home remedies and preferred archival practices throughout pregnancy. Her health continued to deteriorate till she became severely ill at 8 months. But she was still kept at home. And one day, she was found unconscious. Then they finally decided to take her to the hospital. And when they arrived in the emergency room of the district hospital in Sialkot, the doctor said that it was too late. Asma was in coma on account of uncontrolled blood pressure. She had multi-organ failure and a dead baby on board. In spite of all efforts, Asma breathed her last later that night. Throughout history, more women have died in childbirth than men have died in wars. But I'm sure you would be thinking that was history. Today is 2017. But do you know that every single second across the globe, one girl or woman is still losing her life to complications of pregnancy and childbirth? And in the local context, that means one death every 40 minutes, 365 days a year, every single day on a rolling basis, even today. And we, generally, who come from the privileged class, often think that these things probably only happen in movies or stories. But that is not the fact. We are the minority of the privileged people, but we have to open our eyes about the tragedies that are happening in the world globally and also in women and girls like us in Pakistan. 85% of our population does not belong to our groups, and we have to talk about them. And as far as Asma's death, we as a society, as we always do, we just bury them quietly. No questions asked. There's no media frenzy. There are no political statements bombarding the television. And all that you hear is, it was Allah's will. Allah ki marzi thi ji, bas kya ho sakta hai? And business continues as usual. Because we don't see these tragedies happening around in our families. But we have to think about the people who suffer from them day in and day out. So the next question is that, do we not know what is killing these women? About 839 women die every day across the globe. Do we not know what the reasons are? Are there no treatments available? And the answer is that we exactly know why these women are dying. The five main causes which contribute to 80% of these deaths. So these 75% causes, which include hemorrhage or excessive bleeding, infection or sepsis, uncontrolled blood pressure, problems during delivery, and unsafe abortion, continue to be the five major killers that kill girls and women globally and in Pakistan. And would you believe that this is the same diagram that I was taught in 1985 when I was a medical student at King Edward Medical College? The four deadly delays, as we used to call them, as we studied in our medical curriculum, still are the same, and they are always operative in a different proportion in all of these deaths. Recognizing a problem late, making a decision to take her to the hospital, what happens at transit, and the quality of care she gets there. So there has to be a definitely hidden dimension to this problem. And that is very well summarized by one of our Egyptian colleagues. Women are not dying because of diseases we cannot treat. They are dying because societies have yet to make the decision that their lives are worth saving. And when we talk about this, the general perception is that this is something limited to the poor, rural, uneducated people. But that is not. The problems, the spectrum may be different, but the educated, empowered, and the urban women also suffer. Let me just give you a simple example of polycystic ovarian disease. The average delay that a family takes or makes before bringing the girl to the clinic is at least 24 months. This is a common hormonal problem which can be easily treated by simple lifestyle changes and would be of no consequence. But if we leave it untreated, if we neglect it, can cause severe problems for the young girl, like absence of periods, obesity, excessive hair growth, hair loss, even leading to depression and poor self-esteem issues. And not only this, they can have problem getting pregnant later, and they develop diabetes and atherosclerosis and breast cancer much earlier. Just yesterday, I had a professor from the leading universities in Lahore. She looked really pale, and when I looked at her reports, her hemoglobin was only 6, which is supposed to be 12 as a normal. And she had had heavy periods for the past 7 years and said that she just couldn't find the time to come till she actually collapsed in the lecture theater a day before. Just look at breast cancer. The self-examination is available, mammograms are available, the breast cancer can be picked up at a very early stage when there's a success rate of 90%. You can walk away disease-free. But in Pakistan, 90,000 new cases are reported every year. 40,000 women die of breast cancer in Pakistan every year. And 80% of them only present in stage 3 or 4, when there's a lot of misery, there's a horrendous amount of pain, there's a lot of financial implications, but no cure. The world now is witnessing a marked reduction in cervical cancer. But Pakistan, yet again, unfortunately, is a country where cervical cancer is rising. Although we have a vaccination for prevention, we have the Pap test for prevention. So what is going on? What is it that we can help with? Too many women in too many countries speak the same language of silence. Irrespective of your class, your geographical status, and your education, there's a big taboo in talking about girls' and women's health. There's a huge stigma in starting these conversations. And we just don't want to address the problems. We just never think that breast cancer is a cancer that all women are at risk of, so I better get myself tested. We have to learn to speak up about these issues. And we must together break the silence. And at Girls and Women Health Initiative, we have come up with a couple of very simple solutions that can help make a world that we all want to live in. Firstly, allow and encourage the women around you to discuss their problems. It is perfectly okay to discuss a period problem or a hormonal issue or your pain with your mother, with your father, with your sisters, and between husbands and wives. There should be no shame in starting these conversations. There should be no taboo that stops us from doing a breast self-examination. Women have learned to take stand for each other, to encourage, not to hide the problems from the men in the family. And as a society, we need to develop empathy. We have got to believe that women's health is a basic human right. It is not a luxury reserved for a few. It is a basic human right that every civilized society should extend to its people. And secondly, for a long time, we've dealt with women's issues on half grounds. And I agree that men may be a part of the problem in many situations, but men are definitely a vital part of the solution. We cannot win this battle without engaging our fathers, brothers, sisters, fathers, brothers, sons. They have to be on the same side of the conversation. And if it was not for the support that my father always gave me and the confidence he had in me and my husband and my son supporting me, I would not be standing here. So we need to build a bilateral support system, and we need to get rid of this closeness about talking about female body, whether it is a period problem, cancer prevention, contraception, or any other issue like menopause. I would like you to meet Samina, the girl at the back. We met her in a medical camp near Sahiwal in year 2010. She accompanied her mother, who was ill. And during the course of conversation with the volunteers, her mother said that my husband is an addict. I have 5 children, so I'm going to withdraw her from the school, although she's very clever, because I can't afford all that. And I'm going to marry her off, because that will relieve some burden from me. So they brought her over to me, and we had a long discussion with them, along with the host, who's a family friend. The mother finally agreed to keep her in the school because she was a very good student. And this March 2017, I had a phone call from Samina. She was really happy. She was sounding very confident, and she told me that she had just done her bachelor's, started working as a school teacher, and she would probably take her master's privately. I was truly delighted for her, and I was very grateful for the fact that her mother took our advice. But more than that, I was so relieved that that is one less asthma. There's one less number in that mortality list that we generate every single day. At Girls and Women Health Initiative, we do these free medical camps and awareness sessions in the periurban slums, in the villages and also in schools, colleges, and capacity building activities for the government staff. So these are just a few pictures from there, but this picture on the right hand, if you can see those two little girls, this is a living story of the tragedy that a maternal death generates. This is a set of twins standing one behind the other, and there's a little baby. Their mother died giving birth to this younger child wrapped in the pink blanket. And this girl in the middle then decided that she had lost her mother, but she's not going to let her sister have that feeling. So she left the school and she started raising her little sister, and she brought her to the medical camp without any problem. She just wanted to make sure that her sister is doing fine. The father had remarried and was living almost separately. So this is the cascade of tragedy that a maternal death generates. And we need to have a feel for these in spite of the fact that they are not happening in our immediate families or relatives. In these awareness sessions, we have sessions for women and separate sessions for men as well. So the girls and women come, discuss their problems, they have the treatment, they are given advice, but most importantly, we talk to them in these awareness sessions, telling them that there is no shame in talking to your family or your father or your husband about the problems that you have. And the men are also taught and advised that it makes you no less of a man if you listen to your wife, if you care for your daughter, because that's what you would want to do. Similarly, we have sessions in schools, colleges, and universities. And I can tell you from 14 years of our work, padhe likhe ho ya na padhe likhe ho, ameer ho ya na ameer ho, everybody has a family. Everybody has nears and dears, everybody has problems, and everybody wants a solution. It is just that not everyone has that chance. And I urge you all to please become that chance for people around you. And you don't have to go to an peri-urban slum, you don't have to go to a village. Just look around yourselves, your family, your relatives, that little bit of a conservative approached people, the people who work in your offices, your drivers, your cooks, maids, malis, they're all human beings. We are just privileged to be born to the parents we were born to, and we owe it to them to help and support them. A few words from you have the potential of changing their lives. Please do that. I want your support to prioritize pink, to help with girls and women's health and empowerment. Let us think about it, talk about it, take action, lobby up to shape a world we all deserve. And never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, it is the only thing that ever has. Thank you very much.